And now we take a look at illegal child labor in India and the ongoing struggle to end it. NewsHour special correspondent Fred de Sam Lazaro reports.
When Kailash Satyarthi conducts rescue raids of underage workers, he always brings along cameras to document evidence. On a hot summer afternoon, Satyarthi's group quietly fanned out in Delhi's bakery district, rounding up children into waiting vehicles. A local magistrate and police contingent were along in case there was any trouble.
You don't have to fear.
At a government processing center, they'd determine if these children were already registered as missing or if they'd been sold to their employers.
These are all government officials. They're all here to help you.
That's what he told the young men. He told me not all officials are reliable allies and that this day's total of 22 should have been much bigger.
We wanted to rescue at least 50 to 60 children from two areas. Many of them have already hidden. So when we reached there, we could not find most of the children.
Who tips them off?
Sometimes police, sometimes other authorities, and sometimes the local people.
He said the combination of official and middle-class indifference and dire poverty drives perhaps 50 million Indian children into the workplace, some as young as 6 or 7. Most are from minority Muslim, tribal, or lower caste Hindu communities. Many are bonded, sold into virtual slavery, working often in grimy, grossly unhealthy conditions.
Let me see your hands. What we say is that children's hands should have books in them, pens and pencils in them.
But we are helpless. We have to do what we do.
Helpless, yes, but we will see to your studies and try to get work for your mother and father, God willing.
India actually has laws against child labor. School is mandatory up to age 14, and there are funds to rehabilitate rescued children. Despite all that, Satyarthi says it's mainly up to private activist groups like his to make sure the laws are actually implemented.
I am free.
This is Mukti Ashram. This is a transitory rehabilitation center for freed bonded children. All the children have been freed by us over last 1 month or so. First of all, we have to ascertain them that they are free.
But they haven't fully conceptualized it yet?
Not really. They could not do it so fast.
This one is from the day before yesterday's raid.
Frequently, newcomers still stick to instructions they've gotten from employers on how to respond to certain questions, like my first one. How old are you? 15, they said, in boys' choir voices. 15 is a legal working age. More accurate are the stories they shared of abuse when they worked in the embroidery business, notorious for its use of children.
We worked from 8 a.m. till midnight.
If you ever did something wrong, they would beat us. We got beaten every day.
Niaz Ali's story is similar to many others from this group. A trafficker came to his village several hundred miles from here in eastern India. He gave Niaz's parents money to take the boy to Bombay, where he promised he'd be taught a trade and could earn a good living.
How much money did they give your parents?
20,000 rupees.
That's about $400, a large sum for parents who are not difficult to convince that this is their child's ticket out of dire poverty.
Almost all the parents are illiterate. I always advocate that poverty, child labor, and illiteracy are three interrelated cause and consequence factors.
Kailash Satyarthi is an engineer by training, but calls himself a Gandhian by inspiration. He began his advocacy 3 decades ago in India's rug industry, where child labor was pervasive, taking a message to consumers in Germany and the United States.
I had a strong belief that once a person is sensitized towards child slavery, whether it could be carpet or shoes or apparels, you cannot limit that social concern and social motivation. And that worked.
Today, a group he founded, now called Goodweave, offers a labeling system that guarantees that no child labor was used in making the rugs. Some 120 carpet merchants and retailers in Europe and the U.S. now carry Goodweave certified rugs. Some 70 Indian exporters have licensing agreements with Goodweave. They agree to unannounced inspections of their factories and suppliers, like this one in the northern city of Varanasi, producing rugs bound for Australia. After a quick look around, Goodweave staffers interviewed weavers and examined employment records. This producer got a clean bill of health, but Inspector Jawed Ahmed says it's still sometimes a cat-and-mouse game.
Sometimes we'll enter a place and hear people running or scattering, and you have to believe that they're using children. If there are just adults, there'd be no reason for people to run.
Goodweave India's chief Manoj Bhatt says a big challenge for Western importers is to know whether to trust all the layers of subcontractors. At least 500 supply Goodweave's 70 approved licensees.
The supply chain is very, very decentralized and scattered in different districts and sometimes in different states in India. They have to believe whatever their exporters are telling them. And even for the exporters, it's really hard to actually, you know, keep track of what is, you know, happening in their supply chains.
It's villages like this in eastern Uttar Pradesh that are the starting links of the long supply chain that leads to the export houses and the rug markets in the west. From dawn to dusk, you can hear the sound of hundreds of carpet looms.
They're housed in ramshackle buildings. We popped in unannounced, posing as tourists and at times received as prospective buyers. Using hidden cameras and cell phones in Uttar Pradesh and other areas, it was easy to document clearly underage boys toiling alongside veterans who themselves may have been here since they were boys. The appropriate authorities rarely patrol here, and Goodweave's Bhatt says it's out of their control.
That's one of our limitations, that we cannot access looms which are not part of our licensees.
When they're discovered, boys like Zahidol are returned to their families. He was found 4 years ago when he was 10. Poverty might have driven him to work, but Zahidol was not trafficked into the job. His mother, Faratun Bibi, says he volunteered to go to work in the carpet business after his father, the family breadwinner, suffered a stroke, worsening their already desperate condition.
Hey, Baba, what's up, Logina?
After his illness, Zahidul himself said, "Mom, why don't you let me go to work? I could earn some money." In fact, the middleman didn't want to take him. He said he was underage. But I pleaded with him, "Please do it for me."
Just days after he began working, Zahidul was found hiding in a carpet factory hundreds of miles from home.
They told me to roll myself into a blanket, that the people were coming to get me and put me in school.
Goodweave did enroll Zahidul in school. Neither of his parents or two older siblings ever went to school. After showing proof that Zahidul is actually attending, the family receives a monthly stipend to help make ends meet.
How far have you read?
Now 14, Zahidul is in fourth grade and still struggles. He may never thrive in school, but Goodweave's Bhatt says even basic reading ability can be useful. And basic arithmetic is essential to be able to count one's salary.
The idea here is to break that, you know, cycle of illiteracy so that this, literate person can, you know, understand the value of education for their kids.
Goodweave estimates the number of children working in South Asian rug looms is down to about a fourth of the 1 million who once did. But for Kailash Satyarthi, there are always other industries to tackle. It comes at a cost. He's been beaten up several times, and two colleagues were murdered because of their activism, he says. Child labor is a critical part of India's largely unorganized economy, and for one simple reason, he says, they're cheap.
You can buy a child in lesser price than an animal. The buffaloes and cows are much more expensive than buying a child to work full-time and for whole of his life.
He says it's one explanation why India has 50 million children working full-time, and at the same time, 50 million adults, many of them parents of those working children, are unemployed.
Fred's reporting is a partnership with the Undertold Stories Project at St. Mary's University in Minnesota.